Okay, Jean-Jacques Rousseau was born this year exactly 3 centuries ago. Here he is. And we also celebrate the 250th anniversary of his book, Émile ou de l'éducation, of 1762. Although Rousseau was an almost exact contemporary of David Hume, the Émile was not really an Enlightenment treatise, but an early romantic one. Not rationality, but nature guides us, should guide us, in creating the Enlightenment virtues of equality, freedom, and goodness. With the Émile, Rousseau wanted to revolutionize educational practice. It is nature, not human drill, by which the child should be educated. And the first requirement to make this work is for teachers to carefully observe their children. So here are a few citations. Hence, begin by better studying your pupils, because surely you don't know them at all. Observe, and this is necessary for this natural education of the child, and it's a hard education. Observe nature. Follow the route that it traces for you. Nature exercises children continually. It hardens their temperament by all kinds of difficulties. It teaches them early the meaning of pain and sorrow, and goes on. Accustom them, therefore, to the hardships they will have to face. Train them to endure extremes of temperature, climate and condition, hunger, thirst, and weariness. Well, all children he fathered himself were immediately dropped in children's homes to be completely deserted by Jean-Jacques. But that's another thing. although Rousseau had a few observations on children in the Émile, it was not too much, it was limited. Many pedagogues nevertheless took his advice and started developing, started observing their children. In fact, Rousseau's theories became especially influential in German pedagogical circles. Johann Heinrich Campe, an enlightened theologian and pedagogue in Hamburg, organized a society of practical pedagogues that would jointly publish over the years 1785 to 93 a general revision of the educational practice in 16 volumes. And in his preface, Campe pleaded for well-off philanthropists to make available 1,000 thaler for a competition in diary writing. Such a diary on the bodily and mental changes of the child from birth on would indescribably enrich our knowledge of the developing child. There's no evidence that this competition materialized, but a few attempts in diary writing followed this plea. And the first one was Tiedemann. He was a philosopher, and he had kept a diary from 1781 to 84 and published it in 87. It contains well-counted 15 observations on son Friedrich's early speech development over the first 13 months of his life. So, for instance, at 7 months, the child was going to imitate sounds such as ma. And at 8 months, he would point to X when asked, where is X? That's very early. At 21 months, another example, the first sentences appeared, consisting of an infinitive verb and a nominal, without inflections, without articles. Only 1 year later, the mathematician Moritz von Winterfeld published another diary, very much inspired by Rousseau, and it announced, very interestingly, to relate the gradual formation of the quite peculiar language, the very simple children's grammar. First time that term is used in the literature. However, it is mostly concerned about the bodily development of daughter Amalia Louise, far less with mental development. It makes some linguistic observations as interesting as the child can't say the H, in spite of the fact that that is the easiest letter of the alphabet, that sort of observations. But enlightened Winterfeld certainly was. He inoculated his child with his own hands with a pus of a cow's smallpox, and the child got extremely ill over several weeks, but then survived and also survived the next smallpox epidemic, all thanks to Rousseau. The second small wave of diary writing occurred in the midst of the 19th century. Four diaries survive, and the most important of them is Bertolt Sigismund's. Sigismund was a doctor and a teacher in Rudolstadt, and he wrote a really very nice monograph on children's development, containing 50 pages on language development, with a richness of observations of language development in the second year of life, very little on the first year. I will not go over those details, but just mention two theoretical claims that Sigismund was making and that would be influential. The first one is about the function of first words. That the little speaker uses the first uttered words at once, mainly or maybe exclusively, as expressions of will. The proto-language is nothing but the will made audible. Now, the Bund student, Moimann, would 40 years later make the same remark about first words, and that became simply canonical in the literature. The other theoretical remark or claim concerned the child's early phonology, the notion of least effort. Easy speech sounds appear before hard speech sounds, B, D before, say, L, sh, r. Now, that issue of a least principle became, a least effort principle became very important in evolutionary explanations of language development. All in all, however, in the mid-19th century, the diary making had lost its intellectual appeal. These people were not related to universities anywhere. That changed drastically 30 years later, in the years 86-87. Then what had been really marginal, scattered business was suddenly drawn into an explosive scientific development. The French man of letters, Hippolyte Taine, provided the fuse, and Charles Darwin set fire to it. In 76, Taine had published a report on the diary he had maintained on his infant daughter's language development, a report making ample reference to evolution theory. So here's one of his remarks. Speaking generally, the child presents in a passing state the mental characteristics that are found in a fixed state in primitive civilizations, very much as the human embryo presents in a passing state the physical characteristics that are found in a fixed state in the classes of inferior animals, Haeckel's law, that was. Now, the next year, the new journal Mind published an English translation of that French text. This triggered Darwin to publish in the same year, 77, and in the same journal, a 10-page biographical sketch, as he called it, of his son William's early development as an infant. The sketch was based on copious notes Darwin had made between 1839, when William was born, and 1841. Clearly, after reading Taine's paper, Darwin did not want to repeat the Wallace affair. He had been the first to keep a diary over 30 years before Taine, and the world should know. Celebrity Darwin's paper appeared the same year also in French, German, and Russian. not failing to promote the diary business on a grand